Hello, my quilting friends. I'm Leah Day, a professional quilter, author, and online teacher. And this podcast is all about quilting, running a creative business, and balancing our busy hands with our busy lives. You can find the episode show notes and links to everything mentioned in this podcast at leahday.com. Enjoy the show. Hello, my quilting friends. Leah Day here with episode 10 of the podcast. And today I'm talking with Patty Dudek. She blogs at Elm Street Quilts, and she runs two different quilt alongs this year. She's running the OMG project, the one monthly goal. And I am actually a featured designer for that in March. And so each month, if you have a goal, you can post it, kind of share a blog post and link up with her. And then at the end of the month, if you made your goal, you can post again and link up again. And I think it's going to be a really awesome way to kind of get on track with your projects and your goals, and then have an opportunity to not just share that with the world, but also maybe win some cool stuff. I think she's got some giveaways going on too. So you can check that out at Elm Street Quilts. The other quilt along that Patty is running is Bag It, where you make bags, and it can be any bag tutorial that you want to make, and you link up your progress. I think that's super, super cool. So we talk about a wide range of things in this podcast, and Patty has been quilting for a really long time, so she has lots of experience, and she's just a really interesting person and has an interesting perspective from quilting for so long and then now turning it into a business. She's blogging and writing patterns, and I had a really fun time. So I hope that you enjoy this episode. Now for a few updates about what's going on around the house. The Machine Quilting Block Party has kicked off to a great start, and you can learn more about it at leahday.com/blockparty. I've seen so many beautiful blocks. So block number one is available right now, so you can download that and get started making a blooming nine-patch block. And this is definitely beginner-level quilting and piecing. So it's pretty easy piecing. There are quite a lot of little pieces in this block, but it is still very easy traditional style piecing. And then the quilting, I kept it pretty simple, but you're gonna have some challenges. You know, we've got feathers, a really pretty feather wreath in the center of the block, and you'll get lots of experience with stippling and gentle flames and echo shell, just a wide variety of designs. So I've really enjoyed seeing all of those blocks being posted to the Block Party Facebook group. And all week I have been sharing basic quilting, basic tutorials. And what these have been is really just designed to answer all of those beginner questions. Usually around this time of the year, I just get this huge flood of questions. You know, why do you press your seams open? And, you know, how do you get away with that? And why do you use a short stitch length? And do you drop your feed dogs for free motion quilting? So if any of those questions sound like something you're curious about, then you can head over to freemotionproject.com and check out all of those tutorials. So I've been blogging almost every day through the beginning of the year, and that's been fun. I haven't blogged this much this regularly in a while, so that's been really cool. It's definitely kicked off the project on the right foot, and I love being able to answer those questions with a video, because it's one thing for someone to answer, you know, and say, oh, well, here's why I do something, you know, and write it all out. But it's another thing to show it to you in a video and have that ready to go. And so you can see, wow, okay, you know, if she pieces with a short stitch length, then she can press her seam allowances open. And oh, wow, that does make the block so much flatter, you know. It's kind of a reinforcing to all of these different techniques that I teach. So I hope that you'll check all that out and watch the videos. I put them together in a playlist so you can just hit play and kick back. And I think it's probably an hour worth of tutorials right at the beginning just to get you started. So in addition to blogging, all week I've been working on the sashing and cornerstones pattern, and this is a really big deal. I have never tried to teach like the connection process, the quilt as you go process from the beginning, simply because I don't have anything done. I know that sounds bad, but you know, I just I quilt at this project as I go, just right along with you. And so it's been a challenge to me to figure out how to write this without having to just do tons and tons and tons of work right here at the beginning. And that, you know, how to use diagrams to teach a lot of it. That's been a challenge. But it's been a really interesting process, and I'm just going through the math now and making sure, double and triple checking my math, making sure all of that's solid, and the sashing and cornerstones pattern should be available on Monday. And one big thing that I am adding to this pattern, I kind of put up a poll on the Facebook group, and I was curious to see how people felt about the mystery aspect of the quilt. Like, is that something that you enjoy, or is that annoying you? You know, which is it? And the predominant opinion was, you know, most people do not like the mystery aspect of it. They want, really specifically, they want to play with color. They want to be able to know what the colors are going to be and how to tweak them and how scrappy they can go. And sometimes working block by block, it's really hard to see that. And I can understand. That's not really my thing, but I can understand that perspective. So with that in mind, I've decided to put the image of the finished quilt, so you'll see all the blocks, and that's going to be in the sashing and cornerstones pattern. I'm not going to put it in any other pattern, so if you want it to remain a mystery and you want it to be, you know, a secret through to the end, then you don't have to, you know, look at it. Just don't look at page one. So that would solve that issue. But, you know, I felt like it was a good optional extra, where if you want to make the quilt bigger or you want to see the whole quilt at the beginning, then here's this extra pattern that will answer that for you and help you be able to pick your colors better. So definitely check out this new sashing and cornerstones pattern that should be available on Monday. And you'll be able to find that at leahday.com/blockparty too. So another secret thing that I'm just going to kind of give you a few hints about today. I'll be sharing a lot more about this as it kind of all comes together this week. I have been working on a Dresden plate template set, and I have been working on this for months, and it's super, super exciting because it's here. I have, I've got 10 boxes in my living room right now filled with Dresden plate template sets. And what these are for is for cutting half of the blocks of the machine quilting block party. So something that I was designing this past summer was playing with Dresden plates. All I did all summer was just play with different Dresden plates and play with the calculations and different petals and different sizes and stuff. And I came up with these templates. And when I was writing the patterns, I looked at it and I was like, well, you know, it's one thing to sit there and, you know, cut out a paper pattern, and that's perfectly fine. But if you wanted to do more with it, what if I could come up with a set that would cut all of them? And that's basically what I've done. So these are not quite ready to go out yet, but they're very, very close. I need to shoot some videos and create some tutorials for you guys. So I'm thinking these will probably be ready for you in about a week or a week and a half. And I just wanted to give you a little heads up. Dresden plate templates are coming soon, and they do so much more than just cut Dresden plates. These things cut, dozens of Dresdens, tumblers, circles, and I etched them so you can use them for ruler work quilting too. So we're going to be doing all of that and more this year with the machine quilting block party and this new template set. And this has been several months in progress, you know, probably I'd say over 6 months in progress of creating these. And it's such an awesome, awesome thing to have done and nearly ready to go. I'm just super, super excited about that. So on the gallery front, I'm trying to be good and give you guys an update on my gallery each week. And no, I have not made any progress on it this week because I have been blogging every day and making tutorials for the sashing and cornerstones pattern and making tutorials for the Dresden plate templates. So between all of that, I've also been doing several interviews for this podcast. So between all of that, I have not gotten any extra work done on my gallery. And I, you know, that's a shame. I am definitely going to be carving out time for that. I think I'm going to try and start maybe the after lunch time, I kind of in a little bit of a brain fog after lunch, and maybe that would be the time for me to get on the computer and just do a little linking, do a little clicking. I don't have to really think very hard to do that. It's not a tough job, you know, and I just need to make it a priority and start getting that up. Good news is, though, I have been designing more goddesses, and I'm really proud of that. I have been following along with the Spoonflower fabric challenges, and this week's challenge was to come up with a needlepoint. It was a needlepoint theme, and so I decided, okay, I'm going to design a very super simple goddess and do her in needlepoint stitching. So the program that I use for graphic design, which is Serif Draw Plus, you can apply brushes to just a regular line. You can make it look like cross stitching. It's super cool. And so, played around with the program. I drew this girl that I drew her on paper first, and then I transferred to the computer and drew it out. It took about an hour. And then, I was kind of off to the races and drew a lot of different, designs. I did a little heart and, a rainbow and a little house. And so the theme was, you know, kind of a needlepoint cross stitch sampler. And then I made all of these motifs really huge. They're mega sized, and put them all together on the fabric. So I've entered the Spoonflower competition, and you can check that out. I'll make sure to link it up so that way you can go check it out. You don't have to vote for me, obviously, but do vote and cast your vote for what you think is the best needlepoint design, and check them all out. And that's at spoonflower.com. This week's challenge is painting, and so I've already come up with a little design for that. The deadline for all these entries, I think, is Mondays. I'm pretty sure by like 3:00 Eastern time. So to me, this is a really good way to challenge myself to design and to get faster at design and to stop 3%ing it. And what does that mean? 3%ing something. And this is a term that Josh and I have started using with each other quite a lot lately, and it's really, really helpful. Basically, it came from South Park, the television show, the really awful television show. So they had a documentary about South Park and how it's created on Netflix, and I think it was 3 days to air or 4 days to air, something like that. And we've watched it twice. And basically, the guys that create South Park, they create that show start to finish in 3 or 4 days. And, you know, the animation, the writing, the voice acting, all of it is done in 3 or 4 days. And the reason why, the guy said, the reason why they do this is because if they had more time and took more time, then they would only be making it microscopically better, like a tiny percentage better with every change. And his quote was like, I'm only making it 3% better with every change, but then dumping tons and tons and tons more time into it. And it's not worth it to sit there and dump tons of time into something that really is finished and done. You know, it doesn't make sense. So this is my challenge to myself each week, to do a Spoonflower challenge, to design the fabric, and I only give myself that 1 week to work on it. I've got to get it done quickly. I've got to draw whatever it is very, very quickly. I've got to figure out the repeat, however the fabric's going to repeat with itself. And I've got to put it all together in essentially four or five days. And that's totally stopping me from optimizing and nitpicking and going back and back and back over something and really spending way too much time on it. And this is great. Instead of trying to make it, you know, that little bit better, I'm just trying to get it done. You know, I'm just trying to get something put together that looks halfway decent and that fits that design prompt. And it's forcing me to be a faster designer. And that's really what I want to do. I want to design more. I want to see more of my style and my designs in fabric and other things. And I love this. It's really working well. I'm finding that the morning time, like when I get up in the morning and have a cup of tea at the kitchen table, that's my time to draw and design and plan and kind of come up with my ideas. And then usually in the evening, right before bed, that's when I take those ideas and cobble them together, put them on the computer, draw something real quick, play with the repeats, you know, figure out how that's going to work, you know, and, you know, so long as I have that time to fit it into my week and my life, then it's getting done. And I think that's really cool. And if I didn't have this challenge, if it was just, you know, if I didn't have a design prompt and I didn't have a deadline, then I probably wouldn't be doing it. So if you have any interest in any of that stuff and you want to also get better and faster at design, you know, consider doing something like this. Spoonflower is print-on-demand fabric. And the benefit of it is you can upload a design and you can order it right then. And I already have, I bought a yard of my needlepoint fabric and I love it. It came out so cheerful and pretty. And I think I'm going to end up using it in the quilty box, my quilty box challenge for this month. So it was like win, 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 you know, it all came together and it all worked out great. So that was really exciting. So the sponsor for the show this week is my website, leahday.com, where you will find tools and supplies, books, and video workshops to help you learn more about machine quilting. We also have machine embroidery designs. I have a few different machine embroidery designs, and these are really cool because they will stitch out automatically on a embroidery machine. So you can set them up and have them stitching and while you're quilting something else and having a good time. Now, Valentine's Day is just around the corner, so I figure you might want to make something cute for that holiday, and I have the perfect design for you. You can check it out at leahday.com/love, L-O-V-E, and it is a stitch and paint love design. What that means is you stitch it, and then you can paint it. It's so cool. It's kind of like the adult coloring books, you know, this popular craze in adult coloring books, only this is quilted, it is stitched, and then you can color it with fabric paints or fabric markers. So check it out at leahday.com/love, and if you use the coupon code E10, that's the letter E and then 10, then you can save $3 on the stitch and paint love design this week. So check that out, leahday.com/love, and now here's the show. Hello, my quilting friends. Today I'm here with Patty Dudek from Elm Street Quilters. Welcome to the show, Patty.
Lee, thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here.
Excellent. So why don't you start by sharing a bit about yourself and your quilting business?
Okay, well, I'd love to. So I live in Central North Carolina, not too far from where you are, but not close enough to pop by and see you in person. 2 years ago, I retired from a corporate job to really focus on building a quilting business. And for me, there's really two parts to it. The first part is some patterns. So I started developing some patterns and have them available on Craftsy. And the second part is a business around my blog. So I'm building up participation in the blog, you know, sharing, trying to build a community around the blog with quilt-alongs, tutorials, and other link-up kind of events. And, you know, quilting is something I've done for a long, long time. But the ability to blog and to meet people through the blog, that's just been fantastic. So that's been my focus. Last year I ran two quilt-alongs. One was a Bargello quilt. I had never made one before, so I challenged myself to put one together, and then did a quilt along on that. That was a lot of fun. The second one was a paper piece-based quilt along, and I really wanted people to try that medium out because I think it's a lot of fun, a good way to do some great designs for a little bit difficult blocks, and, you know, blocks with small pieces. This year, I got an improv quilt along I'll be doing soon, but my big event is One Monthly Goal, which I think we're going to talk about a little bit.
Yeah, tell me about that. I love the acronym, OMG.
Yeah, it's a great acronym. Yeah, so One Monthly Goal was started by another quilter last year. And midway through the year, she wanted some help with the link up, and so because of some health problems, and so I was happy to take it over. And then this year, I'm just so excited with what we're doing. So first, the base premise of OMG. Quilters declare a goal, so something that you want to accomplish in a given month. It could be finish a quilt. It could be that ambitious, or start a quilt, you know, from start to finish, right? But it could be as simple as catch up on my B blocks or piece that backing. anything you need to do in that month to make progress on a project counts as a goal. And then on my blog, Elm Street Quilts, people link up in the first 7 days of the month. So they link up a blog post, an Instagram post. And then at the end of the month, they come back and say, I accomplished my goal. And they link up again. And, you know, in the month of January, we had 115 people link up, which I was so excited about, watching that number climb closer and closer to 100 and then go over it. But the really best part, well, there's two good parts. One is just people visit each other and, you know, there's a lot of encouragement, a great project, or you can do it. And I just love that part. So it's been a lot of fun.
Excellent. I think that's so wonderful. You know, I don't know about you. I have so many UFOs, unfinished projects, and anything that helps get those projects from in pens to finished is a wonderful, wonderful thing. And I set myself the goal this year is like no more projects in pens. You know, the needles in it, they got to go, you know?
Yeah.
Cool. So what got you into quilting? Do you remember what made you fall in love with it from the very beginning?
Well, probably like many people, one of the very first quilts I made was a baby quilt. But long, long ago, my grandmother taught me to knit, and that kind of got me started on making. And then back when I was in high school, you took home ec. That was kind of like a required course, and that got me into sewing. And I did garments for a while, and then I did just knitting and maybe cross stitch. But it was the birth of my son. I wanted to make him a quilt. That got me started, but I didn't really get seriously addicted to like 15 years ago, where it just was something that I found so relaxing from my day job, just to come home, even if I did 5 minutes worth of stitching. So that's what got me started. And now I do have a lot of, I don't call mine UFOs. I call mine WIPs, works in progress, because I find I have to have a variety of things going on. Otherwise I get bored with something. And so I have projects that'll take me all year and projects that'll take me, you know, a few days to finish, kind of all going on at once.
So how many projects would you say you have going on right now?
I say 7 or 8. Some of them are, like, I just finished making all the farmer's wife blocks. So there were 100 of those. And they're all sitting neatly in a pile. Now I have to figure out how I'm going to set them. And I will not exit the year without those in a quilt top. But it's not something I'm working on right now. It'll be my one monthly goal for one of these months coming up. So, but some of them are small, some of them are big. But about 7 or 8 usually at once.
Wow. Yeah, that is a very ambitious project. I've seen those. Have you ever done a Dear Jane?
I have not. And I don't know that I ever will. Those blocks look tiny. tiny. The farmer's wife ones I'm doing are 6-inch blocks, and I did them all paper piece, which was really fun.
Excellent. So tell me a little bit about your quilting business. You said that you're getting into this, and it's really been about, you said about a year that you really started turning quilting into a business?
Yes, yeah, exactly. So one of my thoughts, my business model here really is to drive, there's three pieces to how I'd like to drive income into my business. So one is through patterns, right? And I'm early days patterns. I have my most popular one was it's a chunky alphabet. It's based on paper piecing. And then I did my second most popular one is probably the first one I did, and I think I need to redo it. But it's a travel jewelry bag, so it's very different than a quilt. I like making bags as well. So that's one element. The other element is advertising and trying to work on affiliate links and things like that. And so that, I have goals to grow that this year. I did pretty good. I met my goals last year, but I want to continue to grow that this year. And the third piece is around writing. And that's my word for the year is brave. I want to get braver about my writing and really put myself out there and try and get compensated for that. So that's the three tenets of my business. That's what I'm trying to build here.
Excellent. And one of our first podcast episodes was about publishing books, and just from Krista Watson, and she and I kind of talked together with Stephanie Palmer about different forms of writing, and her advice was write magazine articles. So have you tried that yet?
Yeah, I listened to that podcast actually. I enjoyed that one. Yes and no. I have Some of my writing will not be quilting. It'll not necessarily be quilting related, but I have submitted a couple pieces that did not get accepted, but that hasn't really discouraged me. That was just, okay, I started, you know, it was kind of like a checkbox to myself. So one of the things that I do have on my to-do list is to try and figure out what quilting publications I could try and submit to try and get an article published, like you said, and kind of build my confidence and my going that way. But
Yeah, that's one of those things, you know, magazines, I think each one has kind of their own unique style. So, like, I did some writing for, I think it was, American Patchwork, and it had a very unique style, and I wasn't really fitting with that. And it was only after the fact I was like, yeah, I probably should have gone more scrappy with those quilts rather than more focus on quilting. And I think each one is very unique and different with what they focus on. So, so in the writing, you know, you've been just blogging a lot. That's your kind of focus and what you're wanting to do a lot more of this year?
I've been blogging a lot, yes. And then every day I'm trying to write the book, right? So that's part of my writing, is to try and make progress on this thing. And then when I get far enough along, then I'll see if anybody's interested in it, so.
Cool. So tell me about the quilt-alongs you're running. You mentioned that, you know, we've got the one monthly goal, and then you also do a bag project every year, right?
I do. So I've done this 2 years in a row. I call it Bag It. And that is something that I've greatly enjoyed. So I publish a series of tutorials on bags. And for me, it's just fun figuring out how to make a new, you know, zip bag, from small zip bags to large project bags. Really anything goes. And during the time period, it's in the fall, you know, people can link up with any bag that they made. And it could be a bag from my tutorial, could be anybody's tutorial, anybody's pattern. It doesn't matter. The whole idea behind it is to encourage handmade for the holidays. That's really the essence, right? You have a friend you want to give a gift to, well, make them a bag, right? Zip bags are so much fun. There's, you know, you have scraps, you can make a zip bag. You have pre-cuts, make a zip bag. You know, there's just so many options out there. So we'll do that event again this year. Well, the Improv Quilt Along I'll announce next week. And Improv Quilt Along is somewhat of a interesting two words to put together, I think, because typical quilt alongs, like the one you're running, there's a pattern, there's tutorials, you know, everybody's sort of making the same thing as the quilt along goes along. The idea here is just to give prompts. So I'm going to give a prompt about make a wonky log cabin. But people could choose to make a wonky log cabin. They could make that wonky log cabin into a mini quilt, or they could make it as a block and, you know, build the rest of it around it and things like that. So they're quite excited about that one. I have two sponsors, and I'll announce that next week. And the actual quilt along will start in February, and then we'll link up in April. And I just really hope to encourage people just to try it. It is so much fun to just take, could be scraps, right? Just kind of sew without accurately cutting and not quite worry about seams for a while and stuff like that. So, yeah, that kicks off next week, and it'll start in February.
Excellent. Yeah, I did a wonky Christmas tree quilt last month, and it was, I think, one of the most popular videos I've ever made. It was really popular. I love the wonkiness because you don't have to play by the rules. It's almost a relief to not have to play by the rules sometimes. So what makes you want to run quilt alongs and to share this way? And you always do like a link up with that too. How does that always work for you?
So first, why do I do these link ups? I think one of the most favorite things about the internet and blogs is just meeting other quilters. And you can meet them, you know, you can follow their blogs and blog readers and things like that. But the ability to interact and to share your work and all get together in a Facebook group or in a link up is just, I don't know, I just find it invigorating, right? To see what it's like, handing a couple of small children a box of crayons and a piece of paper. Everybody does something different with the same supply. So let's see what quilters do with the same supply. So quilt alongs and link ups and the one monthly goal is just a way for people to come together and share. And for me and everybody else, I hope you make new friends, right? You see them month after month sharing their progress, and you visit their blog month after month, and suddenly you start emailing each other, and then maybe you're doing, you know, little bee swaps together or something like that. So it's just a, for me, the link-ups are a way to build a community and, you know, make new friends.
Absolutely. And how has that changed your business? Have you seen that have an impact on your business yet?
Well, I think it's driving more traffic to my blog, right? And so since a piece of the business model is advertising and affiliates, that blog traffic is pretty important. So I've definitely seen that. The one monthly goal event, which I'd like to, I didn't talk about the sponsors. I would like to come back and spend a few minutes on that. But that event has driven some new traffic, people who've not visited me before, but also tutorials and quilt alongs. You know, you see on somebody's blog, they're doing something. You go, oh, I might want to do that project. And that drives more traffic.
Yeah. Tell me about the sponsorships for the OMG project.
Okay, great. Thanks for asking that. So for One Monthly Go, we have a couple of big corporate sponsors, if you will, in the fabric world. So Fat Quarter Shop will be sponsoring it all year. And then so they'll have a prize for a randomly chosen participant. And then Bagmaker Supply, which is an Etsy shop, Green Fairy Quilts, Clothworks, Make Modern Magazine will all supply prizes each for 3 months each through the year. So we have kind of a nice smorgasbord of sponsors, if you would. And then Orfo will supply a prize for the grand finale. And the grand finale really is anybody who enters through the year, I just keep track of those entries. And then at the end, I have an extra drawing, and you can win a wonderful thread set from Orfo. But the other thing that I was really excited to add this year is my designer spotlight. And that's what I'd like to spend a few minutes talking about. So there are so many talented people, yourself included, out there in the quilting world that publish patterns and publish tutorials. And I wanted to find a way to spotlight people that I follow and I really enjoy their work. So I reached out, and I have this amazing list of designers, each sponsoring a month. And that gives me a month to talk about them and share a little bit of their work. And each one of them is supplying a prize, a gift certificate to their shop or a pattern or whatever, you know, as another prize for a random participant. I have gotten such tremendous feedback about this designer spotlight. People think this is the coolest idea, and which makes me really happy because I think it's a cool idea too. So, you know, some people enter One Monthly Goal because writing a goal down and publicly talking about it, that's incentive enough for them. Others like the added benefit of a prize potential. So we got them covered here with some great fabric they might win or a pattern from a cool designer. So it's pretty exciting.
Yeah, and thank you so much again for asking me to be a designer with that. That was just so wonderful. It's always kind of so weird when someone emails me and like, you're a pro, and I'm like, I don't really feel like that, but cool, yay.
Yes. And always is like, you will be March. You will be our designer highlight in March. So that'll be fun to write a little bit about you, because I've been following you since not your very first 365 quilting days. I maybe caught you on day 10 or 12 or something like that. But I've been following you for a long time. So it'll be fun to spotlight you.
Yeah, it'll be wonderful to just to see how many people link up throughout the year and how that helps people progress. And just knowing a little bit about what makes us accomplish a goal. It's, you know, what we do every day or what we see every day or what's, you know, we are actually actively thinking about and getting our hands on that we actually accomplish. So I think anything that helps with that is an amazing thing to do. So what is something that you feel like is really unique to you as a quilter, you know, as you've developed? I mean, obviously you've been quilting for such a long time, and I'm sure you've tried many different types of quilting. So what do you feel like at this point you're the best at?
Ooh. I have tried a lot of different things, and I'd like to do all different things. This might be a strange answer, but I think I'm at the best at finishing a project. And I don't mean the binding part. I mean, I decide I'm going to make something, and I have a plan, and I get it done. Because I don't like to, if I make a quilt block and then I decide I don't want to finish the quilt, I don't throw the quilt block away. I'm going to do something with that quilt block. Maybe I'll make a mini out of it. So I don't know if that's a good answer to your question, but I just like to finish things. So I like minis, large, small, paper, piecing. I don't do much like English paper piecing. I'm not quite, that might be something I should try more of this year. I enjoy it all, but if you just look at the process of putting a quilt together, it's probably the piecing and making the quilt top. I'm still improving my skills on the quilting part, free motion and walking foot.
Yeah, I think that's everybody. We're always improving skills on something. So at this point, you probably made lots. If you're really good at finishing quilts, you probably have quite a lot of quilts finished. So I'm curious, where do you put them all? I'm having trouble with storage.
Yeah, that's a great question. So some of them are gifted, right? That to me is actually one of the best reasons to make a quilt. So you have a recipient in mind, and kind of with each stitch, you get to think about the person, whether it's their birthday or you know, whatever thing you might be celebrating and so forth. So some of them are gifted. Some of what I'm doing now is minis for exactly that reason. Where do you put all the darn things? So, you know, you see a technique or someone has a quilt along and I'm like, oh, I really want to participate in that. Well, I downsize their pattern, right? Instead of making a bed-sized quilt, I'll downsize it and I'll make a mini to hang on the wall. So that said, you know, other quilts are just in rotation. You know, I have my spring quilts and my summer quilts and I just kind of go through it, so.
Do you have a storage method? Where do you keep the quilts that are not being used right now?
Well, my oldest is off in grad school, and his room makes an excellent place to store things when he's not around. There's two beds in the room, and the bed he wouldn't use when he's home visiting has a lot of quilts stacked on it. And then I just use large, really large plastic bags. I have no idea where I got them from, and I roll quilts. And last year, I took it upon myself to inventory all the quilts I have ever made by looking at old photographs. I went to visit my long-arm quilter, and she let me raid her records of things she might have done for me. And I took pictures of everything that I still had, kind of inventoried everything, and then sorted them. So now I, at least for the last 6 months, have a system, right, where I know where everything is because I wrote it all down. We'll see if I keep it up, but so far, so good.
And do you tag all of your quilts?
Yes. Some of them are simply name and date. But if I get creative, the quilt has a name, and I'll put that on there, too, or you know who I made it for. But that, I didn't do that very good early on, and then I kind of learned the hard way, boy, what a bad idea it was not to label your quilt. So now I went back and did every one that I had, and now I absolutely label them as I go.
Excellent. So I checked out your patterns on Craftsy, and I really enjoyed the wide variety of different patterns. So my favorite was the chunky alphabet. I think you talked about that earlier. Tell me what, how are those made? Is it paper piecing or is it like regular piecing?
It's paper piecing. And so the whole way that started is I ran a quilt along last year for a quilt, I called it repeat. So it's quilt, eat, sleep, repeat. And so those were all paper pieced letters. And that was all, while the quilt along was going on, that was all available for free. And then I kept looking at it going, oh, wait, I need another word. I want to do, like I did a quilt that said jingle for make a Christmas table runner. So then I just designed the whole alphabet. And I have used that so many times. For Christmas, I made my daughter a quilt that said awesome. And I enlarged the letters and did it that way. So it was just fun. So it was that's the way most of my ideas flow. I get the idea for something, and then suddenly I see all these ways to kind of build on it. So, but yeah, that chunky alphabet, so much fun. If you like paper piecing, I think it's so much fun.
Excellent. And could you make that wonky without the paper piecing? Like, would that be possible?
Oh, yeah, wonky letters? Yeah. Check out my improv quilt along. That might be one of the profs. You know, because it's, if you, I think so, absolutely. You can also make some of those all traditional piecing if you wanted to. It's pretty easy to figure out, right? But I love putting text in quilts, too. That's one of my new passions.
Absolutely. So this is the last question I always ask everyone, and that is, what are you looking forward to in the next 5 years? You know, whether it's with quilting or your business or personal life, what is the thing that's really making you want to get out of bed in the morning and get going?
Ooh, big question. So I probably say two things. So one is I really would like to publish that book someday. So to actually make it happen, that's probably thing number one. And then, thing number two is I'd like to continue to find the right balance in quilting and growing a business myself and kind of the rest of my life. So I have three kids. They're all adults, but they still need mom. And, I still want to be there for them. So I want to find kind of those two things. My youngest just started in college. My middle one, she has a disability, is still in high school. So I want to get her out of high school, into the working world and still find time for me and my writing and my quilting. So it's those things.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for coming on, Patty. I had such a good time chatting with you today, and I cannot wait to help out in the One Monthly Goal project and see all those wonderful link-ups and everybody's progress this year.
Well, thank you, Leah. It's been a blast for me. I thank you so much for joining. And again, thank you for being one of our designers. Your month is March, so everybody can look forward to seeing your pattern and your highlight in March.
Excellent. So that's it for this episode. If you're interested in learning more and any links to anything mentioned in this episode, you can check it out at my blog, freemotionproject.com. Until next time, let's go quilt.